drugs from my generation. I'll take the fall, the state, and across the nation. And it's a sin to cause the fate, the fraud, the messing with me. Come on, come on, come on, let's get it out.
Move to the music.
The following contest is a singles match set for one fall. Introducing first, weighing in at 240 pounds, hailing from the dark depths of Ohio, he is the Killjoy, J.T. B. Introducing the challenger, weighing in at 230 pounds, he is the real Triple H, Hill Hat Harry. 2!
Two.
Yeah, it was a great match. Great match. Congrats. Oh, also, firstly, great match there, Mr. Heel Hat Harry. I could have asked for a better opponent to help me start off tonight's episode of WPW Saturday Night Showdown, the go-home show for our next pay-per-view, which is next Saturday at 6 p.m. Eastern on this very, very channel right here. Next Saturday's WPW Stand Your Ground. All of the titles on the line. We have ourselves a six-woman tornado tag elimination match, of all things. We have ourselves a submission match brought to us by the Oni Matsumoto, Haruka Daisuke, as she takes on an unknown opponent, whoever it is that's gonna answer the call for that match. Obviously, you have Sergeant Major Payne, who is going to be taking on Fenrir, the man formerly known as Chaos Heretic, in a Falls Count Anywhere match where anything goes. And on the topic of Fenrir tonight, your main event of the night, Merrick the Hunter finally gets his hands on Fenrir. Merrick won a match a few weeks ago, and Fenrir gave him the choice that if he wins the match, he was allowed to pick the stipulation for their match. Merrick did end up winning that match. And so tonight, your main event is Merrick the Hunter taking on Fenrir in a steel cage match. Anything goes inside the steel cage, but there is no escape. So I bet the sergeant is gonna be eyeballing that match very, very closely. But on top of that, we gotta get through some of tonight's card. Well, we got two new debuts coming to us today from the Federation, only known as, I lost my notes for a minute. Yes, so we have two debuts tonight brought to us by the Barathane Gladiatorial Federation. We were later tonight, before those two debuts make their appearance, we will be hearing from the announcer from BGF, I guess would be the right way to say it, the man known as Vega von Hashim. So we'll be hearing him later on today as he introduces us to these two gladiators, I guess. If the name of the Federation is anything to go by. But before we get to those matches, we obviously have to handle all the other matches we have before then. And even now, because we're going to take you guys under ringside for the second matchup of the night. The following contest is a singles match set for one fall. Introducing first, weighing in at 205 pounds, he is the Sheriff of WPW, Montgomery. Props to our announcer who had a very unfortunate voice crack there just now. going towards our very own sheriff. It was actually a part of the sort of investigation into what in the hell was going on with Beowulf and Fenrir and the attacks on Major Payne and Uzra. And we more or less got our answer. And obviously, you got his answer to exactly what was going on. And it's just a good challenger. Weighing in at 200 pounds, hailing from the dreaming city, he is the Awoken Hunter, Siegfried! Siegfried the Awoken Hunter, the man who wears that Raiden flex on his chest proudly. Every time he comes to the ring, he has been making an absolute killing here on WPW programming. Winning match after match. But here we go, and as I was saying earlier, Montgomery, part of that investigation with Fenrir and Beowulf. Beowulf put out a response about a week or so after Montgomery gave his question to Legend Incarnate, and Beowulf's response was, it was confusing to say the very least. Like, I feel like he may or may not have been on something, but I'm not gonna judge. But basically, if I could summarize it any better, he more or less wasn't himself. Because even though it wasn't Beowulf that attacked Major Payne, and even then he wasn't the one who set hell on Uzra. Which, by the way, we haven't seen Hell in quite a while. I don't think we've seen her ever since Uzra made her comeback to WPW, beating the... No offense to Hell if you are watching, but Uzra kicked the absolute crap out of you. And so far, we haven't seen Hell since. We got the revelation close to maybe a month or at least a few weeks ago by the man formerly known as Chaos Heretic, confirming that he is actually Fenrir, the son of the god Loki. As if I didn't have any other problems going on here in WPW. And oh, as I'm saying that, Siegfried winning this match against Montgomery with a shooting star press. And here's your winner, Siegfried. And there's Siegfried once again with another victory on his belt. I'm rambling on about what's happening here. In the meanwhile, Siegfried goes ahead and sneaks the victory as I'm talking. A little bit rude, I might say ever so slightly. But we gotta get ready now for our third matchup of the night, and yeah, and so we got the confirmation that Chaos Heretic is now is Fenrir, the god of Loki, or, well, son of the god Loki. I have too many like ethereal beings. That's too many to deal with, people. But anyway, at Stand Your Ground, it will be Sergeant Major Payne versus Fenrir in a False Count Anywhere match. And in our next match, actually, we will be seeing the other half of Guns N' Glory, Minuano, as he takes on El Cholo Espiritu. So those being said, ladies and gentlemen, let's see you guys on the ringside for our third matchup of the night. The following contest is a singles match set for one fall. Introducing first, weighing in at 215 pounds, El Cholo Espiritu. El Cholo, wrestling out of San Pancho, California. First matchup was against the Genovese and Bull Osman Killick, end up winning that match. And introducing the challenger, weighing in at 275 pounds, he is one half of Guns N' Glory. He is the fourth horseman, Minuano. Man who once ran with a gang of desperados. Where's that mask? There's a reason why he wears that mask, is to escape the judgment of his former gangmates. Because he wanted to leave the desperado lifestyle, and his group, I guess, never didn't take too kindly to that. Left the group after our robbery had went south, which of many things you don't want happening, it's something like that going wrong with a gang of desperados, people that may have been your friends. This man has found himself a new home here in WPW and finding allies with the likes of Sergeant Major Payne. Springboard maneuver there by Cholo. There is a significant size difference between the two. Not so much in height, but definitely in definitely in muscle. I don't think that's gonna deter Cholo even the slightest. As Minuano hits up with that springboard forearm, and actually I take it back about the height thing. Minuano's about a foot taller. I don't think size matters with Cholo still finding ways to bring down his opponent. No matter how big or small they might be. That's up to plan there, but Minuano slamming, like sweeping the leg. Now returning the favor, punch in the face. So we got those, so as stated earlier, we have those two debuts happening later on tonight. We do know, however, that one of the debuts will be facing up against Arctic Mantis. So it's gonna be interesting to see if Arctic is gonna be able to tangle with someone who he has probably never witnessed in action before. I mean, as is the case with any new debut, no matter where you are. You face someone new, you don't have a chance to read their patterns, basically. There you go, both men taking the fight to the outside, slamming the back of Minuano's head on that padding on the outside, the thin padding, I should add. Not very thick, doesn't provide too much coating, I guess? Can't find the words right now. It wasn't until after Resistant Disorder, after Guns and Glory won their fight against the Primals, Minuano actually ended up taking in that bionic arm of his, wanting to get a little bit of an upgrade. And speaking of the Primals, at Stand Your Ground next Saturday, the Evergreen Brothers, Hansel and Gretel, will be teaming up for the very first time as they take on the Primals of Ifrit and Titan. Oh! Forearm off of the middle turnbuckle, and here we go, Kamsen! Got the Kamsen locked in, looking to make Cholo tap out. But Cholo able to power through. There's some elbows to the face. Oh, it looks like Minuano was trying to go for the wolf totem. But Cholo reversing with a power slam. But Minuano immediately able to put things back into his favor. Oh god, he's on the top. What is he looking for? Oh, single leg drop kick off the top turnbuckle. Dragon Cholo to the other corner now. What could he be looking for? Oh, nothing, as El Cholo is able to prevent that from happening. Oh, here we go. It's a Trey Perro following through with a pin, but a kick out at two. Manuano dragging Cholo into the... Oh, here we go! Lucky into Kamsen once again! But Cholo once again able to power through. Looking for power slam there. Cholo reversing with a DDT. I think I must have missed it. I think Cholo's bleeding. I think Cholo got busted open at some point in the match. Series of moves once again, falling with that drop kick. And a big vicious lariat there by Cholo. Trying to go for a splash at that point, but Minwano rolling out of the way. And a European uppercut. And here we go. Minwano looking to finish things off with a wolf totem, but Cholo reversing with another lariat. Minwano with a sweep of the leg. Oh, here we go. Cholo looking for Mas Chingon. Going for the cover up now, two. But a kick out at two by Minwano. Now going to the top rope. Went for a splash, but Minwano once again rolling out of the way. I think both these competitors are slowly getting... They're slowly gassing themselves. Minwano probably more so, given that he's the bigger man. Here we go, Cholo once again going for the cover. Two, but a kick out at two. Oh, here we go. Could be looking for a second Masa Shingon, but Minwano not ready and not willing, taking Cholo into the corner now with a series of big boots and just pressing on to the shoulder. Now getting jiggy with it. Oh, there we go. Dragon Sleeper, the Winds of Destruction locked in onto Cholo. And Cholo is tapping out. And here is your winner, Minwano. Cholo tried his best. Despite the size difference, Cholo didn't. He put up more of a fight than Minwano, I guess, could probably imagine. But in the end, it was the Desperado himself, the Fourth Horseman, who was able to pick up the victory. Now we're gonna take a stroll on over into the women's division now. An excellent matchup between both Cholo and Minuano. And now, ladies and gentlemen, we have to, as we prepare for this matchup, for the second matchup here, going through the rest of the Stand Your Ground card. You have Hannah Matsumoto, who's defending her Synthwave Championship against the superhero Shrike, someone who Hannah's actually been trying to recruit into her grip alongside Haruka Daisuke and Morgan Reed. And on top of that, you have Ignatius Black, who is challenging Keith Von Lau for the WPW Underground Championship. If Keith wins, then Ignatius must join him on his path of God. On top of that, your last two matchups of that night, you have Amber Drake, member of the Drake family, challenging the Primal of Ice known as Shiva for the Rocker Girl Championship. Is it going to be the member of the renowned Drake family, or is it going to be the Primal of Ice? Member of the Notorious Faction. And obviously, your main event of that night, ladies and gentlemen, you have the Creature of the Forest known as Leshy taking on Nicholas Northstrom, the Netrunner, for the WPW World Heavyweight Championship. Is the Netrunner going to come out on top? Well, we're going to have to wait and see. Will we have a new world champ, or will we still have Leshy as they have a possibility of retaining for that night? And now, with all that being said, ladies and gentlemen, we are going to now, I'm being told that both our competitors are now ready in gorilla position. So we're going to go ahead and take you guys down to ringside for this next match. The following contest is a singles match set for one fall. Interesting first. Weighing in at 200 pounds, hailing from the Shirahana Empire, she is the Empress Apparent, Asuka Kobayashi! After Kobayashi off the heels of a very grueling fight between her and Lena, the ninja of the Bishouen clan, actually fought against Amber Drake for a chance to become number one contender, but Amber Drake was the one that came out on top. And introducing next, weighing in at 175 pounds, she is the queen of the winter fight herself, Lady Kath Gina. Here we go, Lady Kath Gina, leader of the Winter Fae. Also a semi-ally of the Primals, actually teamed up with Garuda and Shiva months ago as they took on the Lucha Quins. So, Kathleen, definitely someone you you don't really want to mess with or piss off. I guess both of those things go a little intertwined, but here we go. Starting off the match here, Asuka immediately taking Kathleen into the corner. Oh my god, immediately lifting up Asuka in like this bridging submission. Unfortunately, just like last match, there is a significant height difference and size difference between these two competitors. It's gonna be interesting to see how Kathleen handles Asuka. Oh, crucifix takedown by Kathleen, looking for the cover, but a kick out at two. Imagine if the match just ended right then and there. Taking Asuka by surprise, knee to the face. Now going to the top rope. Oh, went for a drop kick, but Asuka shrugging it, shoving her out of the way. And Kathleen with a very, very big lariat there. Asuka drop kicking Kathleen into the ropes. Oh boy. Oh, big boot to the outside. Goes Kathleen, and following Sue is Asuka. Just clocking Kathleen in the jaw there. See Kathleen getting increasingly annoyed by Asuka. Here we go, another submission, but even if Asuka taps out, won't count on the outside. Asuka tried to get back into the ring, but Kathleen not letting her. Here we go, Kathleen with the wrist clutch assault. We're at the count of five. Six. At the count of six now. We're at the count of seven. Could Kathleen be looking for a count of victory? Eight. At the count of eight, but fortunately Asuka able to get back into the ring at the count of eight. And it looks like Kathleen wants to take the fight back to the outside, taking Asuka onto the apron. Oh, and dropping her onto the apron. Which, from what I have heard, is the hardest part of the ring. Kathleen slamming Asuka into those steel steps. I'd like to remind everyone that I'm joined every weekend, yes, every weekend, by my very own Avian announce team to all of our Avian audience members out there. I can never figure out what they are saying. At the count of seven. Here we go. Both competitors back on the inside now. Oh, count at two. Oh, catching her to the top rope. Asuka was in her sights for a coup de grace, but Asuka rolling out of the way. And Asuka with that vicious pile driver there. I believe that was the Starlight pile driver. Well, here we go. I think this is Mistral's hook. Got it locked in onto Kathjina. But Kathjina able to power through and break out of it. Vicious DDT there by Asuka. Asuka going to the top rope. Oh, what is she looking for? Calling for Kathjina to get back up to her feet. Remember a single leg drop kick by Kathjina, able to dodge out of the way. Asuka just launching her to the outside. Kathjina just eyeballing her. Asuka not taking exception to that, clearly. She heads to the outside, but Kathjina immediately slamming her into those steel steps. Kathjina is attacking the leg there of Asuka, going back to the top rope, could be looking for a coup de grace. One, two. Oh, that was a near count. Near three count. Asuka just barely able to get the shoulder up. Saw it off the top, going for the cover. Two, three. And here is your winner, Lady Kathjina. Asuka seeming not to be maybe not too happy about that loss. Ladies and gentlemen, we are about halfway through the show. So before we get on to the second half, we are going to, we got things we need to pay for, all that kind of stuff. It's not, I don't do the financing here, but we gotta do it. So we are gonna hear from a couple sponsors.
Start your day right with the clean, sweet spice of Brass Kettle Blend Turkish Coffee. One of the day's best perks. Because nobody does coffee better than the Turks.
Put the pep in your step with Lucky Potion, a Did It Alchemy and Catering specialty product.
A couple of the sponsors that we do have, ladies and gentlemen, we have our other sponsor, Magitek Madness. They provide us with all of our WPW equipment needs, from the ring to the backstage area, and weapons. They also provide us weapons. It's legal down here in the underground. You know how it is, people. Thanks to them, we get, at the very least, pretty good connection down here. But obviously, last but not least, I obviously have to give a huge shout out to our primary sponsor of the show, Arasaka Japan. So with all that said and done, ladies and gentlemen, we are going to go ahead and take you guys under ringside to start off our second half of the show with obviously some women's action. Contest is a singles match set for one fall. Introducing first, weighing in at 225 pounds, hailing from the Mojave Desert, she is the California Courier, Brunilda Moria. Brunilda Moria, an employee of Northstorm Enterprises, also the bodyguard of one Nicholas Northstorm, the Netrunner himself. Actually heard from Nicholas last week in regards to his upcoming match, and he actually put out how proud he was of Brunilda and how far she's come so far since her debut. And introducing her opponent, weighing in at 190 pounds, representing Los Lobos de Sea, wrestling out of San Diego, California, the dazzling Dahlia Xochitl Destella. hailing from San Diego. Searching Josea, the cousin of El Cholo Espiritu, who we saw earlier in the night as he took on Minuano. Even though Cholo was not able to win his matchup here, maybe Xochitl will be able to put the odds in their favor by potentially winning this matchup here against Brunilda. But Brunilda herself has also been on quite the roll. It's going to be interesting to see how these two match up. Actually, ladies and gentlemen, I'm also being told I gotta go deal with a thing. I will be right back.
All right, just give me the paperwork and I'll handle it. God, Jesus. Okay, well.
Hello, everyone. I am back. There was some issue in the Dippin' Dot with the Dippin' Dot stand. I guess some Karen didn't get her Dippin' Dots. Didn't get the right Dippin' Dots. I'm confused, and now I got paperwork to deal with. You know how it is, ladies and gentlemen, with these kinds of things. Pardon me. Anyway, back to this matchup here. We have Xochitl. Oh my goodness, looks like I may have come back in just in time. As Xochitl hit the Sinaloa Sunset on to Brunilda, but unfortunately was not able to get the pin. And I'm getting a text message from Vega, who we'll actually be hearing from after this matchup here. I got a text message from him saying, oh good, the Hazaloon haven't found the Dippin' Dots. Where the Hazaloon? Why do I have to deal with more people? I have enough to deal with as it is. Oh, here we go. Back to that matchup here. Dropping Sochi's head on the knee there. Now going to the top rope with a coup de grace. Oh, Sochi going to the top rope now. And hitting Brunilda with the frog splash. Going for the pin. What a kick out at two by Brunilda. Evening announced team going absolutely nuts over this match. As Brunilda taking Sochi into the corner. Oh, and slamming her face onto the mat. And look at not even going for the, not going for the pin there. Interesting. She's got something obviously more planned. Hitting Sochi with another coup de grace, but a kick out at two once again by Sochi. We know this is Lucky 13, or Lucky Sarez, it's also known. Sochi's got it locked in onto Brunilda, but ooh. Sochi followed through with a cover up there, but a kick out at two by Brunilda. Right, here we go now. Sochi locking the legs around the head of Brunilda, trying to make her pass out. Oh, and a big fist to the face. Going to the top rope, calling for Brunilda to get back up to her feet. But Brunilda rolling out of the way. Oh! Slam your down bridging maneuver, but a kick out at two. Oh, here we go though. The referee, I guess, is already ready for the Mojave Bomb. Two, but a kick out at two by Sochi. There we go once again. Denial of service being shown to Sochi. Oh, trying to go for another Mojave bomb, but Sochi reversing with a DDT. We're going to the top rope. Oh! Brunilda had the knees up, ready for high note. And a big knee to the face. A referee just eager to get this pin count. Brunilda had something going, had something trying to go there, but Xochitl reversing that with a power bomb. Oh, here we go. And Xochitl ending things off with a Sinaloa sunset. With the cover now, 2, 3. And here is your winner, Xochitl de Estella. That was quite an outstanding matchup between these two competitors. Well, Xochitl and Brunilda were both ready for what the other was trying to accomplish. We may have to get our referee out of here because he completely photobombed that shot. Well, in an outstanding, amazing match between these two. Gentlemen, we are now going to get ready for our last three matchups of the night. These first two matchups are featuring brand new debuts here in WPW. In a partnership with Barrett and Gladiatorial Federation, we are actually now going to hear from the announcer of BGF, Vega Von Hashim, as he introduces us to these two brand new competitors.
Creatures and beasts, concepts and constructs, mortals of all ages. I am Vega von Hashim, High Priest of Lundtakur, and the voice of the Barathane Gladiatorial Federation. Starting this week, my humble show will be working in joint with Wolfpack Wrestling to bring you a pair of our unarmed contestants. Luther, the Crimson Wolf Balfenheim, the bare-knuckled brawler who not only matches but surpasses contestants in our own midweight armored division, and Anaj of the Mountain Avondash, the Eshrak Bruiser from our squad combat division, a master of lithomancy and numomancy, the high-flying gladiator, and owner of the prestigious Avondash Luxury Towers. With this, I do hope you all enjoy the show this week. And as we say in Barathane, strike first and draw blood.
So hashtag strike first, draw blood from Vega. So we have our two competitors joining the ranks of WPW. We have Anaj Avondash and Luther Balfenheim. And we are going to waste any time, ladies and gentlemen. We are going to see who these two competitors are going to be facing. Well, we already know that Arctic Mantis is a part of this like little debut triumph thing. I'm not entirely sure, but we are going to go ahead and take you guys under ringside as we get through our first new debut. The following contest is a singles match set for one fall. Interesting first. Weighing in at 280 pounds, hailing from the land of Sparta, Odysseus! And the Spartan warrior himself coming out with that signature sword of his that he jams it into the ground. I'd also like to remind everyone here that WPW is not responsible for any audio hiccups, video hiccups, or anything that may occur during our broadcasting. It's not us, it's just the Underground. And introducing his opponent, wrestling out of the Bofenheim estate, weighing in at 275 pounds, Luther Bofenheim. Here we have Luther, as Vega called him the brass knuckle brawler. The bare knuckle brawler, my mistake. This is definitely a man who looks like he's ready for a fight. Oh, he's wrestling bare feet. Interesting. But here we go. Start of the matchup here. So I guess we now know who Arctic is going to be facing in the next matchup. He will be going up against a Naj of the Mountain Avendash. Actually, tweeting on social media. We have Arctic tweeting out in regards to his upcoming match. WPW, let us welcome these new competitors from BGF. New fighter, I hope you are ready to fight a man such as myself. I am Arctic Mantis, and may the hunt be in your favor. And here we go. Odysseus taking Luther to the outside. He's got something planned. He's on the top rope. Oh, and Luther catches him and slams him down. Oh, able to wriggle out of the way of whatever it was Luther may have had planned for the outside. Our even announced team going absolutely nuts over this new debut already. Thank you.
Odysseus going for the splash there, but Luther rolling out of the way. Odysseus lifting Luther up and hitting him with a running power slam, going for the pin now, but a kick out at one by Luther. So from what I understand, as I got notes from Vega, that apparently the entire thing with BGF was to basically make your opponent bleed. So it was more of a gladiatorial thing in the most literal sense. So that is terrifying, knowing that these two competitors are from said federation, and I'm a little bit scared if and whenever the commission has me face either of them. There you go, Odysseus lifting up Luther. Show of strength, but now dropping him down. For the elbow drop off the top turnbuckle, Luther reversing, big forearm to the jaw, and a Kamigoye to follow through. Oh, Luther locking in this hold. I also got notes as to what Nagin Luther's moves are, so thank you, Vega. You are a fine friend for WPW. There we go, Odysseus locking in. And there we go, Odysseus beating the drums of war across the chest of Luther. As Luther drops to the outside in front of the announce table. Given Luther's background and Nash's background, I imagine getting them to the outside of the ring is probably the last thing you want to do when it comes to a match between these two. With a count of six, but Odysseus, it will be able to make it back in on the count for the count of 10. Big foot by Luther, going for the cover now, two, but a kick out at two. And Luther chucking Odysseus to the outside. Thank you. At the count of four, Luther just brutalizing Odysseus on the outside of the ring. Now rolling him back to the inside. I think that was bloody toll there by Luther. Now going for the pin, but Odysseus able to get the leg on the ropes. Referee catching it. Odysseus with a vicious powerbomb there. Oh, here we go. Odysseus trying to lock in a Boston Crab. Onto Luther, he gets it. And it looks like Luther able to power through. Seems like Odysseus might be slightly underestimating. Well, I can't exactly call them a rookie, given they already have experience. Lifting Odysseus up. Oh! Spin kick to the jaw! I think that was Vicarious Price? Is what he calls it? Now Luther once again taking Odysseus back to the outside. As we established earlier, definitely a place that Odysseus doesn't want to be in right now. Reverse DDT there by Luther on the outside. Taking Odysseus back up to his feet. Oh, what a day. Hey, watch it there, buddy. Oh my god, damn it, let me get the knocked over the mic. How nice. But thankfully both competitors back on the outside, back on the inside, but Luther with an inside cradle. And almost getting the three count on Odysseus there. Odysseus once again flexing out to the crowd, lifting Luther up and down before dropping him back onto the mat. Luther obviously taking exception to that. Why Luther is called the bare knuckle brawler. He just busted open Odysseus. A series of palm strikes and a top rope springboard moonsault. Odysseus lifting up Luther and hitting him with another running power slam. There, but Luther rolling out of the way. Series of Kamigoyes being delivered by Luther. Another clock to the jaw. One, two. But a kick out at two. Oh boy. Luther with bar fight onto Odysseus. Now once again going for the cover. This could be it. Two, three. Congrats to Luther on an outstanding victory here on WPW. Welcome to Saturday Nights. Before we get on to the next debut of the night with a Nash Avendash, getting a message from Vega saying good fight, and I'm also being told that apparently this crossover has been sanctioned by the blood god Lunatakur. I think that's how you pronounce it. My apologies if I butchered that. If I butchered that name,
whoever that god is, please don't kill me.
I'm a very good and healthy non-religious man. So no worries. Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, I'm being told that the next debut is ready, as well as Arctic. It's gonna be interesting to see how he handles an Edge of the Mountain Avendash. So, ladies and gentlemen, with all that being said, I think it's safe to say that we gotta get ready for our penultimate matchup of the night. So here we go. Contest is a singles match set for one fall. Introducing first,
weighing in at around 325 pounds, hailing from the frozen north, Arctic Mantis. Introducing the challenger, weighing in at 396 pounds, Anash Avendash. Well, now I know why he has the nickname of the Mountain. Oh my goodness, look at the size. He was pulling off those moves in his entrance. Well, Arctic immediately tried to beat him down, wanting to show this new guy what he's made of. Wrestling out of the realm of Raz Hashim, this city called Tanagra. Yes, from what I understand, Anash is a real estate owner. I hope his prices are good at the very least. But oh my goodness! That man just pulled off a moonsault off the top rope onto the back of Arctic Mantis. I am already scared. I think Arctic may want to. I think Arctic needs to rethink his strategies here. We have a big ass high flyer here apparently. With a vicious DDT there to Arctic. One of these days I'll have to eventually get an interview with Anash and Luther, see what they're about. What were their, the only notes I got was that apparently Luther loves a really good fight. Clearly, if the last match was any indication, and Anash is also a real estate owner, so yeah. Meanwhile, Arctic here, a renowned hunter of very, very cold temperatures. That mask of his is actually the skeleton or the skull from a monster that him and his family hunted. It's apparently a family heirloom, passed down from generations of his family, I guess. And Nash trying another springboard moonsault, but Arctic was able to thankfully roll out of the way. And Arctic returning the favor by doing a splash on the back of Anash. This kind of makes me wonder though if this man feels pain. Ar-
Arctic with a discus punch there to a Nash. And ladies and gentlemen, I think I may have forgotten to say at the top of the hour, I believe that we have got ourselves a hoss fight between these two gentlemen. Nash now with a swoop of the leg to Arctic. Oh, oh my goodness. Just tossing Arctic to the outside of the ring like a sack of potatoes. Both competitors back on the inside of the ring, and Arctic with a headbutt to Nash. I guess that skull does provide some really good protection there, as he literally just headbutted horns on this man. Arctic now just trying to flex on top of a Nash. Now Arctic to the top rope and an elbow drop onto the back of a Nash. Now trying to lift him over to the other side, going for the cover up now. Two. And a kick out at two. Now tossing and Nash to the back to the outside. Obviously, I believe we've already established that these folks here from BGF enjoy a good outside of the ring fight. At the count of five, Arctic looking dazed a little bit, maybe a little too dazed. Six. At the count of six, and Ash slamming him into the barricade. Seven. At the count of seven, slamming him into the steel steps. Eight. Nash heading back to the outside to reset the count. Yeah. Arctic trying to get the, trying to bring the fight back into his favor. Three. Here we go, locking in, locking the submission onto a Nash. Obviously, there are no pinouts or submissions on the outside of the ring. And as you're quickly able to power through it. We are at the count of five! With a Nash hitting Arctic with that power bomb! I don't even know anymore. I think we're at the count of six, the standing shooting star press onto Arctic near the barricade. Oh, wait, hold on. I think Arctic's on the bear. I think Arctic just got knocked out. Nine. I think Nash is going for the count out. I think Arctic just got knocked out with that forearm by, what was that? I think Arctic got knocked out.
And here is your winner, Anesh Elvendash. Here we go, Anesh, winner of this match, albeit with a little bit of a controversial end there. You see the ref checking on Arctic after that big fist that he received. Actually having a couple people from our timekeepers area checking in on Arctic. Looks like he's coming back to his senses, thankfully, but oh man. So note to self, don't fight Anesh. Okay, good. Putting that in my handy dandy little notebook here. And there we have it, ladies and gentlemen. That was Luther Balfenheim and Anesh Elvendash, both the bare knuckle brawler and the mountain. And I'm getting another text from Vegas saying, them bones crunchy. EGF are quite interesting folk. I guess Arctic's calling for, he's been taken to the back. I guess he's calling for, an 18-wheeler? I didn't think those existed. Huh. Ladies and gentlemen, you would think that was the end of our night, but yo, no, you are sorely mistaken. We got one more matchup here, ladies and gentlemen, and this matchup involves the man now known as Fenrir, the son of Loki. Man who attacked Sergeant Major Pain backstage and enlisted the help of his sister Hel, attacking Uzra, angering both Minuano and Merrick the Hunter respectfully, tried to pin the blame on the legend incarnate Beowulf. But the revelations a few weeks ago confirming that it was indeed Fenrir that attacked Major Pain after attacking Beowulf in a matchup, and actually a 2-on-1 handicap match between Merrick and Minuano. But now here we go. I'm a little bit scared. Fenrir called upon both these competitors to face each other in a matchup. The winner got to face Fenrir first. Loser got to face him at a later date. Minuano was the first man to face up against Fenrir, not able to pick up the victory. And now Merrick, the next man up to face Fenrir, ended up winning a match a few weeks ago, and Fenrir gave him the choice. If he wins the match, he got to pick the stipulation, and Merrick answered with nothing other than a steel cage match. No escape, just pinfall or submission in this matchup here. And so, ladies and gentlemen, before we get started here, tweeting out from, I guess, just a representative of BGF,
A friendly reminder, WPW receives the benefit of the resurrection as staff at the BGF. Bones will be properly set and healed in record time. Well, that's good to know at the very least. So we got two parts of medical staff here. One provided to us by the Matsumoto family, and another, a resurrectionist by the folks over at BGF. So cool. And we're actually tweeting out on social media. We have Merrick the Hunter tweeting out, "Time to let out the feral beast that lays docile." And so with all that being said, ladies and gentlemen, it is now time for your main event. Merrick the Hunter of the Marauders takes on the beast Fenrir. Without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, let's take you guys down to ringside. Is a steel cage match set for one fall. There is no escape. Introducing first, weighing in at 250 pounds, representing the Marauders, Merrick the Hunter! Here we go, Merrick the Hunter prepared for war! Introducing his opponent, weighing in at 280 pounds, he is the Beast, Fenrir. Oh god, we haven't seen him with this entrance in a while. It's almost eerie. Question remains, ladies and gentlemen, is Merrick ready? We'll be right back.
There we go, the cage being dropped down. Ultraman Wang looking to show their battle scars here tonight. And Fenrir immediately on the offensive here. Merrick catching the leg, Dragon Screw. Drop the boot onto the chest. Can't imagine how long Merrick must have waited to get his hands on Fenrir after what he did. Those ropes there, very close to the cage. And keep in mind, ladies and gentlemen, here in WPW in steel cage matches, there is no escape. The only way to win is via pinfall or submission. Now locking in, speaking of, locking in a submission maneuver on the Merrick, able to wiggle out of it. Slam onto Merrick. Apologies if I'm not speaking too much, ladies and gentlemen. I'm kind of just letting the match speak for itself. Very intense as... Oh, correct me, that was Thor's anvil there. I haven't been able to name out Fenrir's moves in quite a long time. What was Merrick looking to do? And he hits him with that. With the top of maneuver. Fenrir with a sweep of the leg. Elbow drop followed through. Now here we go, locking a sleeper hold onto Merrick. It's not going to be enough to bring Merrick down, but I wonder how much more he can take. Merrick now lifting up Chaos, taking him into the turnbuckle, dropping him down. continuing to go after the arm of Fenrir. I'm going back to the top rope here. Is able to connect that. Take the top rope maneuver onto Fenrir. Dropping the back across the chest once again. Imagine both Uzra and Sergeant Major Payne are looking very closely at this matchup here. Even though Uzra has plans going up against the Lucha Queens next Saturday, along with Zavala and Serpica, Major Payne will be facing this very man next week in Falls Count Anywhere competition. And once again, Thor's Anvil onto Merrick. Going for the cover, but a kick out at one. Goye, but a kick out at two. Oh, Merrick slamming. I almost said Chaos Heretic. Not anymore, no. Almost slamming Fenrir into the steel cage. A series of vicious knee strikes to the gut. Oh no, we know this. Fenrir looking to go for Gungnir onto Merrick. One, two. But a kick out at two! Once again, gotta wonder, how much is Merrick gonna be able to take that? Fenrir is a god! Like, not a demigod, at least I could be getting my facts wrong, but this man, he's very powerful. He's a very powerful person. I tried to go for the cover there after that float of the DDT, but now hitting the Hunter's Buckshot onto Chaos. Two, but a kick out at two by Fenrir. Now going after the legs of Fenrir. Now going for the pin. Two. Kick out at two, though. Oh, here we go. Now wrenching. Now trying to make Fenrir tap out, locking the arm in. Putting the odds back in his favor, dropping Merrick under those ropes. But Merrick catching the leg, dragon screw. And Fenrir with a big DDT. With the Kamigoye Oh, and Miro the belly to belly. Onto Fenrir now, just like putting the beat down on the face there. Fenrir with another DDT. A series of suplexes, going for the pin now, could be it, but no. Merrick going back to the top rope, and once again with that amazing maneuver off the top. Now a series of chops across the chest. Big knee strike. Got those metal knee pads there. Also rusted, so watch out in case you get tetanus. And now with another Hunter's Buckshot, that could be it. Two. And a kick at it too. Probably wondering if anything can put this man down. Lifting Merrick up and hitting him with that running power slam. And a falling throw with a follow-away slam. Oh, Merrick tried to go for that float over DDT of his, but Fenrir reversing it. Tossing him across the ring. And another Kamigoye by Fenrir. A lucky in a submission onto Merrick. That could be it. He's got it locked in. That could be it for Merrick. And he's tapping out! Stipulation picked by Merrick, Fenrir once again able to come out on top. All right, well, there you have it, ladies and gentlemen. That was your main event. Merrick put up one hell of a fight, but in the end, it was the god Fenrir who was able to keep him down. This is the man that Sergeant Major Payne will be facing in his return to action next week. Tweeting on social media, Merrick, after heading to the back, saying, "I wasn't going to stop until I got every ounce of energy out of you, Fenrir." So I imagine that the matchup between Fenrir and Sergeant Major Payne is going to be watched very, very closely by multiple members of the roster. This beast is unleashed and unstoppable. Being said, ladies and gentlemen, that is where we are gonna wrap it up for this go-home show for WPW Stand Your Ground, which will be taking place next Saturday at 6 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on this very channel. So that all said and done, I am your host, JTB, and I'll catch you guys next week at Stand Your Ground. Have a good night, everyone, and see ya.